to present and how to prepare the presentations. How come I decided to give this idea, this presentation? Well, during every meeting, in every relay, you can see people asking for presenters. I know that there are people who know a lot in the club. There are people who could pass this knowledge, but maybe they need a little bit of encouragement. So, I want to put... So I wanted to give them a little bit of how to do this. Well, what did I decide this presentation? I already told you a little bit, but I was asking this question to myself many times during the previous few days, especially when preparing the slides. So the short answer is because I like to visit. The long answer is why? The club is becoming known for its great presentation. We had many people presenting very interesting topics. The presentations go online, people view them, and they attract a lot of attention. However, to have this great presentation, we need great presenters. We have already many people presenting, but still, Pete is always asking for presenters. So, this is a chance for you, those who have not presented yet, to come forward and show, tell someone. Why did I decide to talk about it? Well, I have over 15 years of experience in presenting. I started from, well, my first presentation actually it was pretty big because it was a workshop for higher ups, managers from banks, from financial institutions, and I did well. It was my first time for important people, and actually I got a prize from them. So it's not that difficult. You can do it. If I did it, you also can do it. Anybody can do it. Also, you will notice that during the presentation, I'm referring a lot to my own experience. It's not that I like to do. I actually want to tell you about what I screwed up and how I managed to not to do it again. What I saw, what other people are doing, what I did not like, and I never tried to do it again. So I'm just talking from my own experience. And why do I tell you that? Well, one of my advisors told me very smart thing. Dumb people don't learn. Smart people learn from own mistakes. Wise people learn from mistakes of others. And I'm letting you, the wise people, to learn from my mistakes. So, why you should present. Most of you are working professionals. You have to work with people, you have to share your knowledge, you have to share your findings, and you do it during meetings when you present something. During meetings, you work with different people. Sometimes they are friendly, sometimes they are not. Club meetings are a great chance to practice presentations. You have very friendly people, very friendly audience, and I assure you, you will not find such friendly people everywhere. Sometimes you have an audience which is outright hostile. You have people who try to trash you. And presenting to such audience, if you're not an experienced presenter, it's very, very difficult. And can be a traumatic experience. So practice here. This is where you can train yourself in get into presenting. Another reason why you should present is that you can talk about your hobby. This is hobby. You are here because you like ham radio, you like operating, you like building. This is an interest that all the people share. So you're talking to people who think like you. So this gives you an advantage because you don't have to make up reasons to make people interested. They are already interested in the topic that you want to present. Another reason, great quote. If you can't describe a problem in simple words, you don't understand. And this is very true. And presenting a problem actually means that you have to put it in simple words that someone who doesn't know it, who doesn't understand it, will understand it. Many times, when I was preparing a presentation, when I was teaching someone, I actually was learning myself. I was finding what I didn't know. I was finding where were the holes in my knowledge, what I was doing subconsciously, but actually needed more formal approach. So preparing a presentation is a great opportunity for you to learn. Well, from software development industry, there is a way to debug a problem called rubber duck debugging. What is this? You take a rubber duck. You have rubber duck on your desk. Take this rubber duck, look at the rubber duck, and try to explain it, what the code that you're working on does, line by line, statement by statement. In many cases, after you finish explaining the problem to the rubber duck, you know the answer. You know what is the problem. The problem was that you did not understand what was the problem. By explaining it, you understood. So, another reason. Having the presentations posted on the website is actually a great chance to show off yourself, show off your skills. Especially when the presentation is posted on YouTube, on the club website, many people are looking at them. And I had a situation that someone contacted me after my SMD presentations, if someone contacted me if I didn't want to present, give this class somewhere else. At that point, I was in a situation that I really could not commit, so I just let it go, but it happened. It also may happen to you. Give them a good presentation, people will notice you. If you're a professional, when you give a few presentations, when you gain experience, when you build a professional portfolio, you can add a very important bullet point, teaching. This is something what may not always count, but actually is important in engineering experience. You have to teach people, and when you have this experience, you're much more likely to get a good job. You will find many people who are afraid of sharing knowledge. Well, actually, this is not true. Every expert has some secret sauce that wants to keep from others, that wants to keep to himself or herself. However, this is a small part of the knowledge. And if I see someone who is reluctant to share simple things, talk about simple things, I have very high doubts about this person's skills, because this person considers simple things as the secret sauce. A true expert will tell you pretty much everything you need to know as a beginner, without even touching the expert knowledge, because the knowledge that you pass to the beginner is just basics. Pretty much everybody knows. So don't be afraid. You're not selling your secret. We are a group of hobbyists. We have different jobs. We come from different backgrounds. We have one common interest, from radio. And nobody is an expert in every field of ham radio, of radio operating. We have in the room experts in many things, on antennas, on RF design, and so on and so on. And we have people here who would like to hear about it. I would love to hear about building antennas. I would like to hear about Merit Design. So it's waiting for one of you to present this topic. Others will be very glad to hear. If you're not an expert in technical topics, well, you don't have to be. There are many people, including myself, who just start, who just got their license, and they would like to hear about how to operate radio, how to operate on the air. You can do it. You can share this knowledge. This is also very valuable. You don't have to go into technical details. We had a great example of such presentation. It was Ham Radio and Cherry Blossom Festival in Bristol. Very nice presentation. Not going into technical details. Just telling the story. So, be brave. Tell about something. Last but not least, well, sharing this knowledge is fine, but presenting to the cloud you see a lot of recognition. You see not only as a person who comes, eats the food, listens to others, but also as a person who gives to others, who gives to the cloud. Also, it become apparent for me how much it helps during the field day. I'm pretty new to the cloud, and if I didn't goof here on the stage, pretty much nobody would know me. But because I gave, this is my sixth presentation, I gave so many presentations, people know who you are. And whenever I needed help during the field day, I just went. I didn't need to introduce myself, I didn't need to tell who I am. People were helping me. It doesn't mean that people wouldn't help me if they didn't know me. No, of course they would, but this would require a little bit more explanation why I asked them for help. Also, when someone was asking queries, I'd say, oh, there he is. It helps. And sharing knowledge is fun. Well, I told you that I present because I like it, and I really do. I was presenting during workshops, I was presenting for professionals, I was presenting for students, and I really like it. This is challenge. This is challenge. Preparing a good presentation is challenge, but I like it. Helps him to learn, helps him to understand, and helps him to share what I know. So, how should you prepare for the presentation? For me, these are four stages. First, finding the topic, then building the story, preparing the presentation, the slides, and in the end, presenting. And I will talk shortly about each one of the stages. So, choosing the topic. You have two choices, either choosing something you know well, or choosing something you want to learn about. If you choose something you know well, you can build on your own experience, preparing the presentation, preparing slides, preparing for answering questions, it will help you to understand the problem. Simple as that. If you choose something you want to learn, you will have to do much more work, but also you can do very well. When you talk about something you know, you have an experience in presenting this topic, you can actually recycle the presentation you made, you gave before. Many times I was taking, when I had to prepare a presentation on something, I was taking my old slides, putting them together, I had brought this presentation. I know people who take one presentation, delete, add some slides, and speed another presentation. They can do it like 5 a week. So this is easy. If you're preparing a speech presentation about something you don't know, well, this may look very intimidating to someone who never done that. May look difficult because it requires quite a lot of work, quite a lot of research, but it's much more rewarding. You're not just learning on what you know, you're learning new things. And this is something usually what you can use in the future. You can actually use this opportunity to learn something, to learn about something what you always wanted to learn about, never had motivation. So when you're picking the topic, one thing, actually at any stage of preparing presentation, know your audience. This should be your mantra. You have to remember this at every single stage of preparing and presenting. Even if you speak about generic things, like for example myself talking about presentations, you always should tune the presentation to the audience. So today I'm talking to radio amateurs, radio operators. So I added some information which is specific just for us, for radio operators. If I was talking to someone else, this presentation would be different. Why should you do it? Assume that you give to, you can give two presentations. One on the same, exactly the same topic, one which is tuned to your taste, to your interest, and another one, let's say, will be prepared on the same topic for geospatial intelligence students. There is a chance that this presentation tuned for you will catch your interest. The other one probably will be smart. This is the same topic, just different approach. So this is why it is important to actually know to whom you talk and prepare the presentation to the audience. I've never done it myself, but I saw people who were burnt by preparing wrong presentation for the audience. They were talking about topic which was interesting for these people, but they did not include something what would catch their attention. And it was a disaster. One guy said after some presentation that he would never ever present again to that point. And it was a topic that should really interest those people. So be careful. Okay, so you have the topic, you send an email to Pete that you want to present, Pete accepted. Now it's time to actually prepare the presentation. Many people think that presentation is just building slides. This is wrong. This is totally wrong. First thing you should do is to build a story. Because when you present, you tell a story. When I'm presenting to you, I'm telling a story. When I was presenting the class about SMD, I was telling a story how to work with those components. All your presentations are stories, and you have to build them. And this is the first thing you should do. Build a story. So you have to know when you come to, you have to know what to tell to the audience. You have to figure out what they would be interested in. Without a story, good story, your presentation will be just a bunch of slides. You can show pictures. Nobody will care. But if you put them together in a story, you have a good chance to grab their attention. You should make sure that your story flows. So there are no sudden jumps in topic, there are no sudden jumps in flow of the story, because this actually is very destructive. Make a jump and you get people lost. Maybe they will catch up, but not always. And at this point, you lost your audience. You lost. You wasted your time. Tell a story. You don't need to be a storyteller to tell a story. I'm not. But I'm trying to build a nice, smooth storyline and then follow it. And this really helps. If you ask me to tell a story, I will tell you like a couple of sentences, fine, I'm done. But because I prepared the story in advance, I know what to talk about. I can tell you this story of preparing presentations, of working with SMD, whatever. My preferred way of building the story is to imagine that I sit there, when you are sitting now, and I'm listening to someone telling my story. and I'm imagining what I would like to hear. And this works really well, because then I can see where are the problems, where I get lost. I know it's not, it sounds difficult getting into someone's shoes, but with a little bit of practice you can do it. And you can switch immediately between the roles, the listener, the audience, and the presenter. Do it. And you'll see that the story will come along just by itself. But consider yourself guide for the audience. You're guiding the people, you're guiding the listener, the listeners through the story. So, first thing, you have to make sure that people know what you're talking about. So, not everybody has the same experience as you do. Not everybody knows the same things as you do. If you're talking about technical subject, whatever, give in the beginning some introduction, which will help people to understand what you're referring to, what you're talking about. Doesn't have to be long. Sometimes one, two slides are enough. Sometimes you should spend a little bit more time. But give people a chance to catch up with you. Again, know your audience. Know what these people may know, what you may expect from them to know. Know what you have to explain. Because otherwise, you will fail. Next step, preparation of slides. If you're a guide to the story, your slides are a guidebook, and treat them like this. This is a guidebook for the audience and for yourself. You think that I'm looking at the slides because I don't, well, I remember the story, but I don't remember exactly what I wanted to say at this moment. So I'm looking at the slides, okay, this is this bullet point, this is this bullet point. That's what I wanted to say. So this is guide for me. This is also guide for you. You're listening what I'm saying, but suddenly you started to think about something else, you stopped listening to me, I'm talking about something completely different. You don't know what I'm talking about. But you look at the slides, okay, it's this bullet point. And you immediately know where you are. Having slides actually is not mandatory, it's optional. Some people like to present without slides. Fine, that's great, they are great storytellers. I find it difficult, so I find it much easier to present with slides when I have the guidance. However, I was in a situation that I lost the slides an hour before lecture. Okay, what to do? I have no time to recreate this slide. I have no time to do anything. Panic? No. I need a story. So I was going to talk about something, so instead of showing slides, I started the program and I was presenting on the program. Nobody noticed anything. But I need a story. So as you see, if you know what you're talking about, it may work well without slides, however, it's much easier. Much easier with slides. So, what are the slides? I recognize two kinds of slides. One is descriptive, styles of building the slide decks. One is descriptive, one is illustrative. What does it mean? Illustrative slides are just a bunch of pictures. So this can be pictures from your trip, this can be pictures illustrating something, but these are pictures, no text. If done correctly, it may look very well, may be a very good impression, but they may be difficult to follow, because there are no anchor points, like in text when you have bullet points. And also, illustrative slides don't work well if you put them in line. and you want people to look at them. I've seen many presentations like this. They must have worked very well during the presentation when the presenter was talking about their story, which is illustrated by the pictures. But when I looked at the slides, I really didn't know what was going on. On the other hand, descriptive slides contain a lot of text. So each point is described in text. The story is told by the story told by the presenter extends the story on the slides. However, this is the basis of the story. And if you have the slides, you can easily reconstruct. Such slides, descriptive slides, make a great learning resource because they can be viewed and they can be read without actually needing to listen to the story. Listening to the presenter adds to the story, but does not substitute. What works best for me is a kind of mix between the two. I like very much the descriptive slides where I have text, but sometimes you need to have a picture. Because the picture may... Because you have to show something, and the picture can be much more descriptive than text. So, use your organ or Jasmine. How much text to put on the slides? Well, it depends on how much value you put into making the presentation a learning resource. I had professors who were putting like pages of text on the slides. It worked well in a small classroom when people were sitting to the close to the screen because text was small. Also, it was very convenient when we were studying because we had everything on the slide, so we could just read them, and this could be the only learning resource or the main learning resource. However, having much text discourages from listening. So, when there is a lot of slides, text on the slides, I find myself just reading the text, not listening to the presenter. So, written from my own experience. These are problems that I encountered in my or someone else's presentation. So, I fully agree with
you. Well, there are probably a bunch of us here who have been putting on briefers at one point or another. And so, there might be discussion about whether some of those points that you made are valid and added by them. I recognize that your learning is more of teaching.
As I told you, I had teachers who were giving like pages of text on the slides. It was great for study. However, for presentation outside of classroom, it's not a good idea. Okay. So, pro tip, keep the slides relevant to the story. Each slide should be relevant to what you're talking about. Of course, some slides are more important, some slides are less important. It's never that all the slides are of the same importance, but each slide should have own place in the presentation, in your story. If you created a slide with no intention of showing it, you wasted your time. Even if you create it, just hide it. Don't show it. But don't skip it. Don't show it to the audience, to the people. If you're recycling your presentation and you include slides you're not going to show, it means that you did not put enough time into presenting this. You don't. This is actually, you don't have, well, People will not know what you're going to say, first of all. But don't show slides which you don't, which you are not want to talk about. There's nothing more distracting than slides which are disconnected from the story. Don't do it. I've seen a presentation on someone was showing pictures. And the pictures, it was someone was talking about their trip. And people, the pictures were jumping automatically from one to another. And they were switching back, but actually every time the picture switched, I was thinking, okay, what they are talking about? I ended up not looking at the pictures, which by the way were beautiful, but just listening to the presenter. So I was actually receiving only half of their presentation. When you have this connect between the slides and the story, you cut one half of the presentation. Some people will look at the slides, some people will listen to it, not both, because they will be disconnected. It may happen that you want to show a picture, which is not relevant to the slide. It's fine. But make it relevant. Put it somehow in the story. So for example, you're talking about your shark and you want to show how great cat you have. Okay? So tell about your cat listening to the radio. Or tell why you had such bad reception the day before. But make it relevant. By the way, I just showed you two pictures of cat, which were completely not relevant to the story, and still they were part of my story. So see, you can do it. That'd be great. Timing. Before I give my first important presentation, my boss told me one thing that I will remember to the end of my life. Give or take 2 minutes per slide. Of course, it's not a hard limit. You don't have to sit with a stopwatch and measure the time. But on average, make it more or less 2 minutes, and it works great. The 2 minutes is just enough time to not to bore your audience with just one picture, one slide. And this is enough to tell about everything what is in the slide. Don't put too much text, because then you will extend it. Don't try to not to put a little, because then you will just waste a slide. Of course, the slides are different. Sometimes some slides are more important, some slides are less important. On some slides you can spend several minutes discussing something. On other slides you will spend like 30 seconds. But keep it on average 2 minutes. Constructing the slides. Always remember that the slide deck is just a tool which helps you to tell the story. This is help for you to go through the presentation, through the story. This is help for the audience to keep up with you. Make them clear and follow the story very closely. There's nothing worse than slides disconnected from the story. Keep this always in mind. Organize the text in a way which helps audience to follow it. And actually bullet points is a great tool which helps to organize text in this way. However, bullet points is also the worst thing, the greatest curse of slides to people who don't know how to use them. And now I need to look at my notes. Okay. February 1st, 2003. Some of you probably know what happened on this day. Early in the morning, Space Shuttle Columbia started to the maneuver of re-entry. Around 8:59, just before this time, the crew reported that they were entering into the fireball mode. This is the time when the heated gas actually changes into plasma and cuts off all the communication. And this was the last thing that people heard from them. Around 8:59, the space shuttle broke into pieces. What's happened? A piece of foam fell off the external tank and damaged the heat insulation on the reactor. During the atmospheric entry, the plasma got into the structure of the wing and damaged the structure of the of the space shuttle, which broke apart. Of course, there was great investigation, and the investigators looked at everything. Turned out that the fact that the space shuttle broke apart was not a surprise. Engineers analyzing video, high resolution video from the start of the shuttle, noticed the piece of foam falling off. And they analyzed it, they simulated, and they came to the conclusion that actually this piece of foam could damage the shuttle. Part of the investigation was also analysis of communication between the team of engineers and NASA managers. And they came to the conclusion that the problem, the problem was with Portman slides. Actually, it was one slide which discussed potential impact of this piece of foam. Can you find where this is? You have 5 seconds. It's this piece here. Hidden, this should be top slide. This should have all slide. This should be title of the slide. Instead, it was buried 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 levels of bullet points deep. And if you include the parentheses of one of the levels, even 6. Nobody reads this. If you look at the slide, okay, this is important. Yeah, this is somehow important. Yeah, okay. Something. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, what is in cafeteria today? Nobody reads this. And it was put in here. Another problem, language. Overpredicted penetration of coating is significant. Overpredicted. Significant energy is required. Again, contradiction of significance. Once the title is penetrated, can cause significant damage. Okay, but probably will not. This is the most important line. Minor variations in energy, blah, 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 can cause significant title damage. But after all the significance which were contradicted, nobody paid attention to. And this is analysis done by Edward Tufte. This is one of the top experts in information visualization, and he was actually leading the team of analysts who were analyzing the slides. You can see what he wrote. This is available. If you're interested in this, this is available on his website. This is available in his books. And if you're interested in information visualization, really check this guy. He's the god of information visualization. So probably nobody will be in such a situation, but you see that constructing the slides actually has a great impact on the message that you receive. Respond, present. So you build the story, you build the slides. The day came for presentation. this is actually great stress to come here and talk to you. Do you feel stage fear? Well, you're in good company. Many actors, many musicians do it, but they are able to overcome it. Do I feel it? Of course. But actually, every time I think myself, why did I do it? Why did I volunteer? But as soon as I start presenting, I'm focusing on the story, on telling you the story. And I don't think about the fear. Also, one thing helps to overcome it. You came here today to listen to me. And this is most important to me. I cannot let you down. Again, when you present, know your audience. Adjust, even after you build the slides, adjust the presentation to what people, how people are reacting. Many times I was changing the way I was presenting based on the response from the audience. So I wanted to, I initially planned to spend more time on something. I did not see much interest. Okay, I skipped over this. Another thing that I did not think was that important, but I saw that there was a lot of interest. I elaborated more on it. So have the connection with the audience. See what they want. Another important thing, dress for the audience. When you talk to a bunch of developers from Silicon Valley, don't wear a suit, because they will laugh at you. Even people who are managing multi-million dollar funds and giving money to companies go to meetings with such people in t-shirts and flip-flops. Because when you wear a suit, tie, those people will not want to talk with you. On the other hand, if you talk to a bunch of people from a bank on the East Coast, don't worry too much. No matter what, who you talk to, what you wear, always be professional. Remember that being serious in how you do something is optional, but you should always be serious in what you're doing. This also applies to presentations. Always act professional whenever you talk to friends or customers or to the club. Always come prepared to the presentation. There's nothing worse than someone who doesn't know what the presentation is about. When you don't know something, well, it's okay to say that you don't know, as long as it's not your only answer. But once or twice per presentation, well, okay, you don't have to know everything. And actually, it's when I see someone who tries to make up an answer, I see that the person doesn't know something. And actually, I assume that he doesn't know anything. And trust me, and this is pretty obvious. How to behave on the stage? Well, be professional. Don't try to speak like this, speaking boring voice, because you will make people fall asleep. Move on the stage, wave your hands. There are people who actually it's dangerous to stand next to them. And I've seen professors, very serious people doing this. There's nothing wrong with it. You're actually showing your enthusiasm for the topic. Keep attention to the body language. This is very important. This is not obvious, because you may act, you may do things that you're not aware of. And some things I noticed when I watched the presentation, when put them online, I noticed one thing. I was holding my hands in the pocket. It looks awful. So what was the presentation? Your movements are also affect how you are perceived. As I said, don't stand like this and talk with a boring voice. If you don't feel confident, you may help yourself with cards. Many people do this. It doesn't look great, but it's acceptable. Try to just to tell from your own story, but you can use cards. It's okay. Last thing, very important, questions to the presenter, especially when you're giving presentation on technical topics. If you don't have questions, it means that you wasted time. Because either everybody knows everything, and you wasted time presenting the topic, or nobody understood anything, and you wasted time because nobody gained anything from this presentation. So don't be afraid of questions, of answering questions. Don't be afraid of asking questions. Actually, asking questions is a great way to be noticed. I've had a situation once that it was an event organized by a big networking company, and I happened to ask a few difficult questions to one presenter, to another presenter. During one of the presentations, I got an answer, okay, we don't know that, but we're checking the documentation, and we'll get back to it. This is one of the situations when it's okay to say, I don't know, and being professional. But I asked the question. A couple of weeks after the event, I got a phone call. I didn't know the number. I didn't have it in the phone book. I had no idea who it was. Anyway, I picked it up. It was someone from a company inviting me to interview. Turned out that actually they went to the organizers. First of all, they fished me out. I had no idea who they were. They knew who I was. So they must have asked the question who I was. Then they asked the organizers about my phone number. It wasn't public. So they actually did a lot of work to find me, just because of this few questions that they asked. So don't be afraid of it. Okay, that's it. And I hope that you will line to Pete, wanting to sign up for presentations.
Do we have a question time here?
Well, yeah, I was going to say that it's the last stream. We didn't hear you ask for any questions.
Questions?
Well, when I present, I will frequently have various backup slides, and sometimes, especially for a more interactive one, I don't exactly know the direction it's going. And so in that case there, I don't consider it a waste of time having more slides prepared than will be used. A lot of it depends, of course, on the direction you take.
But after the backup slides, I usually after the last slide.
Yeah.
And you don't show them unless you really want to. So, as I said, hide them. Either it is hide in the presentation or move them to the back. It's a great idea to have backup slides, especially when you expect that people may have additional questions. But if you don't feel that this is important for the presentation, don't put them in the mind of the presentation. Yes?
Yeah. Well, first of all, the comment about the, going back to the slide, about how you barely bury a very important fact, like about 5 bullets in, that is an excuse.
Right.
In my life, because I'm also in spaces. I'm in satellite, not human flight. But when you see that thing there, when I do a presentation, because I've done many, you put that slide at the bottom in big, bold letters. To be part of the bottom line. If you ever heard the term bottom line, that's what I put.
I'm very glad to hear that you don't do it. But this is slides from actual presentation. Unfortunately, someone did this, and people died because of this.
Yes, and that's my point. Yeah, exactly. The point is, okay, you need to put a bumper sticker at the bottom. I mean, that's what I'm trying to say, is that that is wrong.
And as I showed you, it was not the only thing wrong about the slide, but barring here, made sure that nobody noticed it. This should have, it should have been on slides. Yes?
No, I missed the first part of your presentation. Yes. I'm trying to figure out how to get back to
the slide. This slide.
I was told this out here. Nevertheless, I think that you present, you do a lot of presentations with your dogs.
I work at a university. I'm not a lecturer, okay. But I get invited to give a lecture in classes.
Which university?
Jefferson. So I give presentations to students. I gave many presentations to professionals. I was teaching during workshops. I actually don't waste any occasion to give presentations. This is my sixth presentation here.
Okay.
And one more.
And by the way, you're getting better each time.
practice. Yeah. And one more thing I want to tell you about questions. It's more of a comment. On many occasions, you have dedicated slots for questions. But sometimes in less formal situations, it's okay to ask questions during the presentation. So for example, when you have like a conference, it's unacceptable that you ask questions during the presentation. But during meetings like ours, during workshops, it's okay. And these questions can turn actually into discussions. I had a situation. I was teaching a class during a workshop. And the class started, I think, 9:30-ish, then I had 1.5 hour, then was another class for 1.5 hour, and then there was lunchtime. The discussions and questions turned out to be so intense that I took 2.5 hours. Of course, the next class got canceled, but nobody complained because it was actually a valuable discussion. These people were there to learn something, and we were there to teach them. And the discussion was not because they were arguing about something, but they were actually asking questions about the topic, very relevant to the topic. They were drilling down the topic. So this is one of the problems with questions during the presentation, that it's very difficult to manage time when you have people asking questions. And this is the main reason why the conference is your questions at the end. More questions? Yes?
How do you handle a question like this? How do you make sure the rubber duck can speak English before you explain your software?
I don't care. It's not difficult. Why, you can even explain to your boss, which is worse.
Uh-oh.
But it's important that you explain line by line, detail by detail. That's it.
All right. Thank you very much.